also a level one sommelier in the Court of Master Sommeliers. And the Court of Master Sommeliers.
I heard that's one of the hardest tests.
Yeah, but I'm, that's why I'm only level one. Yeah, if you've seen the movie Some, I'm not that. like the very first thing that you do to start moving on to that. So I'll be speaking to you about the intersection of those two things, spirituality and wine. And a quick outline of our time here, I'm going to go over Anglican spirituality a little bit. Then I'll dig a little deeper into the Bible and what that has to say about wine and hospitality. And then we'll have I was going to have a short small group discussion, so we might, if it stays kind of about this number, some of y'all might have to move up to be in small groups, so just to let you know. And then I'll give you my philosophy of wine when we come back from that. And like I said, we'll end at 7 so people can go to the gala. The rest of us can stay for some Q&A. And hopefully some of you can come downstairs for some wine tasting afterwards if you're free for that.
Where?
At District, which is the restaurant downstairs. And I'll check in with you again about that later. So I'd like to share with you a prayer from the Episcopal Prayer Book. This is a prayer for the good use of leisure, which I hope that you are all enjoying this weekend. Let's pray. O God, in the course of this busy life, give us times of refreshment and peace, and grant that we may so use our leisure to rebuild our bodies and renew our minds, that our spirits may be opened to the goodness of your creation, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
As I said, I am an Episcopal priest. The Episcopal Church is the American branch of the Church of England. So when I refer to Anglican spirituality, the Church of England is our historic ancestor. And all the various churches related to the Church of England, Church of Canada, Church of New Zealand, Australia, Church of Taiwan, those are all considered part of the Anglican Communion. Anglicans as a Christian denomination are unique in that we are both Catholic and Protestant. You may have heard that the Church of England was founded by Henry VIII when he wanted to get a divorce and the Pope wouldn't let him do that. That is partly true. However, when Henry created the Church of England, it was still Catholic in every single way, except for allegiance to the Pope in Rome. Some years later, his daughter, Elizabeth I, incorporated some of the Protestant reforms that were happening on the continent, such as with Luther and others like him, into the church. And she was really the architect of what's called the Via Media, the middle way between Catholicism and Protestantism. So the birth narrative of our faith gives us a unique perspective on spirituality, which is, to my mind, made up of two parts. The first part being our approach to theology, which is known as the three-legged stool, which is on your handout. Did everyone get a handout?
Yeah.
Oh, I'm sorry. It wasn't working. It wasn't big enough to see.
I know. I kind of spilled something.
Oh. Oh, yeah.
So where are these?
Handouts will be brought to you.
Okay.
You need one too. Yeah, if just raise your hand and he'll bring them to you. Because on the handout you'll see a drawing of the three-legged stool. It's made up of, oh, sorry, that's the first part. The second part is our approach to worship, and I'll get to that in a little bit. So the first part, this is our approach to theology, the three-legged stool. So it's made up of, the first leg is scripture, which is essentially the Bible. The second leg is tradition, particularly church tradition, so our hymns, our prayer book, everything like that in the church, our seasons that we observe, like Lent, those are part of church tradition. I realized I left my cool sommelier jacket up here because it has my Court of Master Sommeliers pin on it. But I don't really need my jacket. It's not too cold in here. The third leg is reason, which of course refers to the intellect, but it also includes the whole mind. So your emotions and personal experience as well. We use this concept of the three-legged stool in our approach to theology so that when we encounter a problem, a concept, a question, we evaluate it according to those three concepts. For example, if you have a hot button issue like immigration, we first look at what Scripture has to say about it. You always start with Scripture. We then look at what the tradition has to say about it. And then what our particular cultural tradition says about it. So in America, for example, what are the laws and practices we have concerning immigrants? Then finally, we look at reason. What have philosophers and scientists said about it, as well as what do you think in your own mind, your own feelings, what do you think about it? By examining all of those together in context with each other, we can discern what seems to be the correct stance as a church, or at least a path forward, the next step. This approach has been used since the beginning of our faith. It was built into the foundation. It doesn't only apply to social or political questions. It applies to church-specific, more arcane things, such as, should we have a pope or not? We don't. You can see this approach is very rational and deliberate, and thoughtful. It takes time. It requires educating yourself. It requires cultivating the ability to see things from many different angles. It requires contemplation, using the mind to connect with deeper matters. And it also requires testing ideas and decisions together in community. So we don't tend to say, I have a personal revelation from God that I'm going to share with you. Or even that I need to follow. There's certainly room for individual inside revelation, intuition, but it's viewed as just one part of the whole. And that's in contrast to what some of you may be more familiar with in evangelicalism and Protestant or Pentecostalism, where there's a lot of, you know, God put a word in my heart to share with you, as well as that individual relationship with God. The personal relationship with Jesus Christ. Did anybody grow up in the South? No? I did. So you hear that expression a lot in the South, and you don't really tend to hear it in Anglican churches, unless they're in the South. So in practice, this theology leads to things like the prayer book, right? We're very much people of the Word. And we believe that the repetition of the words that we find in here, from which we draw the blueprints for our worship, form us into better Christians, better followers of Jesus, hopefully better people. So for us, rather than meditating with a mantra or in silence, as in a lot of Eastern and mindfulness practices, we tend to contemplate words and language and ideas and meaning more intellectually, and we do use a lot of words in our services. So you see, I opened with you with some words from our tradition. That's something that you always find in Anglican churches. Come in. Welcome. So all of that is one half of Anglican spirituality. The second half is found more broadly in the liturgical churches, so that includes Catholic, Roman Catholic, Orthodox, and Lutherans as well. Those are all considered the liturgical churches. What we share is embodied worship, meaning that we worship with all of our senses, sight, sound, touch, taste, smell. And you can see a lot of them on your handout, hopefully. I have a beautiful color picture. Sorry, yours are black and white, but I'll start with sight. You see the beautiful vestments and beautiful altar cloth there. It's all intricately woven in with brocade. We like to worship in beautiful buildings, surrounded with beautiful things. The most beautiful church buildings in the world are Catholic and Orthodox and Anglican. That's not due to a lack of talent or design ability in Protestants. It's a theological choice. Beginning with Calvin, sometime after Luther, Protestants became actively anti-visual. They did not want anything to distract from the felt experience of God or the correct understanding of God's scripture. In the picture, you see, there's a chorister over there, the guy and just standing off to the side in the white and the red, or you can't see the colors, but off in the plainer outfit, that's a chorister, so you're probably hearing some beautiful Anglican chant as this sensing of the altar is happening. The quality of music, of course, varies with the venue, but we do definitely value beautiful music in Anglican churches. We have a very strong choral and organ tradition in Anglican churches, as well as beautiful congregational hymns that you probably would recognize easily. The smell, you can see he's got the incense going. You can see that smoke. There's wonderful incense smell in our churches. There's flowers up at the altar. If you're close enough, you can smell the fresh flowers. Some churches, if you go at Christmas time, the sanctuary will be filled with evergreen and even full trees. And it's like a pine forest in there. It smells amazing. Touch. You will feel your knees on the hopefully soft cushion as you kneel for prayers and confession. If you don't feel the soft cushion, you will have a much more intimate experience of the hard floor than you would ordinarily just standing on it. You'll feel the hands of people as you pass the peace. We typically shake hands at the passing of the peace. Sometimes you'll be given a candle to hold, depending on the service. And you'll feel the communion bread when it's given to you, placed in your hand, which leads me to taste. Now, in most churches, you won't really taste the bread. It's just a thin wafer that's hardly recognizable as food. But in my own church and in some others, we do use real bread, and it tastes good. But regardless of the tasteless bread, in every liturgical church, you will definitely taste the wine. It's usually a sweet wine, port, or sherry, which are more practical because they're higher alcohol content, so they don't have to be stored specially before going bad. So all that is to say, we have an embodied spirituality as well as the intellectual one. And to make that link with wine, that's something to me that tangibly encompasses both of those things, the sensual enjoyment of wine and the intellectual appreciation of it as well. So with that in mind, I'd like to go deeper into the spiritual witness about Jesus and wine. When I talk about scripture, I simplified it and said it was the Bible. We have this concept also of the book of Revelation, the Bible. This is not a Bible. This is a prayer book. There is a Bible in it. Sorry. Don't want to confuse you. And the book of nature. And the book of nature is everything that we can read and know and study and understand about science. So that is also very important and valuable to us in our belief system. Most of it is not going to correspond to theology. I mean, we could get this, I'm getting on a rabbit trail, but the further back you go back in time, there was that correlation. You know, there was not really a separation between religion and science, because the people who were smart about science were also in the church, or the Greek philosophers, to go back even further. So, you know, you'll see scientific arguments about how when you eat the bread, it literally becomes Jesus' body, and how that can be scientifically proven, you know. So if you go back far enough, there's like no shade between science and religion, but we're beyond that. Yes?
Yeah. Was the wine that people drank 2,000 years ago quite similar to ours today, or was it much weaker?
There's differing theories on that. You may know more about this. I've heard it both ways, and so I'm not really sure what current thinking is, and it may be different for different countries.
Yeah. What made me think of that, you just said that it would be much easier to preserve and keep if it were higher alcohol content, and that seems
exactly
more refrigeration.
So the common belief is that it was much lower in alcohol content, and that's why they drank more, and they tended to use wine or any other fermented beverage because it was safer than water, right? So you can't really be drinking it all day long if it's higher content. But then I've heard that more recent discoveries, you know, that they feel that the resin that they've discovered is actually higher alcohol content. So I don't know. Do you have any insight on that?
There's some recent research that the wines that we know now are very, very similar to thousands of years ago. Just this very, very quickly, side note, the great wines of Bordeaux that we think of as one of the greatest red wines in the world, their wines, they used to go to the Rhone Valley to get grapes to punch up the alcohol content. So I think it's both. I think there are some that are stronger, some that are weaker these days.
Can we move on to the next?
Sure.
All right, cool. Thank you. I need permission. Okay. Ah. Does anyone here know what Jesus' first miracle was? Oh, I see a lot of hands. Yes.
Wedding at Cana.
Huh?
The wedding at Cana.
Oh, yes, the wedding at Cana. More commonly known as water into wine. So is there a brave soul in the room who would be willing to read some scripture for us?
On the third day, there was a wedding in Cana of Galilee, and the mother of Jesus was there. Jesus and his disciples had also been invited to the wedding. When the wine gave out, the mother of Jesus said to him, "They have no wine." And Jesus said to her, "Woman, what concern is that to you and to me? My hour is not yet come." His mother said to the servants, "Do whatever he tells you." Now standing there were 6 stone water jars for the Jewish rites of purification, each holding 20 or 30 gallons. Jesus said to them, "Fill the jars with water." And they filled them up to the brim. He said to them, "Now draw some out and take it to the chief steward." So they took it. When the steward tasted the water that had become wine and did not know where it had come from, though the servants who had drawn the water knew, the steward called the bridegroom and said to him, "Everyone serves the good wine first, and then the inferior wine after the guests have become drunk, but you have kept the good wine until now." Jesus did this, the first of his signs in Cana of Galilee, and revealed his glory, and his disciples believed in him.
The very impracticality of turning water into wine is part of what makes it so special, because it's not the kind of thing that we expect from God. It's not what we would dare to ask from God. So it shows us the elaborate lengths of God's generosity and love for us. God provides the means for us to enjoy life much beyond the basics that we need to take care of ourselves. God gives us not only more than we deserve, but more than we even think to ask for. In order to understand what it means for the eternal God that Christians worship in the person of Jesus Christ, for that person to begin his public ministry by making a bunch of extra wine, we need to examine Jesus' context, which was first century Israel-Palestine. Good hospitality was a life or death matter. Travel was dangerous. It was life-threatening. There were no modern benefits like easily accessible restaurants or hotels, or often even basic protections of life and property. Keeping to your own tribe and clan was the best way to ensure your safety. And that very tribalism often led to hostility towards strangers passing through your territory. The only way to make that system work was the expectation of hospitality. We will let your people pass through our land, and we'll offer them food and drink and shelter, and we expect that you will provide them the same thing in return, quid pro quo. Hospitality was not about good manners and pleasantries, but was a bonding ritual meant to ensure everyone's safety. There was also obviously no TV or internet, so banquets, such as the one in that story, were one of the main sources of entertainment. Jewish wedding banquets at this time typically lasted for 7 days, much longer than the Mensa AG. So you can see why it would have been easy to run out of wine. Hopefully we won't. And you couldn't just run down to the store and buy more. So the wedding feast is probably the best thing that's happened to the village of Cana in quite a long time. So when the wine gives out, Jesus, interestingly, with an assist from his mother, has compassion for these people. He knows that their lives are probably full of a lot of hard work and not much else. And so Jesus extends the party. A few years ago, my husband is faithfully videoing me, so that's my husband, Dan. Hi, Dan. We took a trip to New York City, and on our way to the airport, we found out that the apartment that we planned to stay in was suddenly unavailable. So Dan got on the phone and contacted an old high school friend who lives in Manhattan, and he asked if we could stay that night. And the friend agreed, and we got in really late, but he still stayed up and welcomed us. And then well after midnight, when most hosts would be saying, well, I guess it's time to go turn in now, we somehow started talking about wine. And I mentioned that I had gotten interested in Pinot Noir lately. And he said, oh, are you interested in Pinot Noir? I happen to have a fantastic bottle of it downstairs. And so he went down to his wine cellar. Yes, he has a wine cellar in Manhattan. Awesome. And he brought out this delicious bottle of wine, California Pinot, and we drank it until it was gone. He'd already offered us more than sufficient hospitality for the evening. But instead of seeing unexpected guests as the imposition that we, in fact, were, he treated us like a cause for celebration. He understood the same thing that Jesus understood in that moment when he tells the servants to fill the jars, that the celebrations of life are all too brief and fleeting, and we should take the opportunity to extend them whenever we can. That, to me, is spiritual hospitality, going beyond what anyone would even think to ask for, creating moments not of discomfort, but of joy. Hospitality is a discipline, no less than prayer or meditation. It's not only a matter of obligation, but of creating joy. Jesus' first miracle, the foundation of his whole ministry, revolved around creating joy for others. In my worshiping community in Pasadena, we always follow our services with a meal, including wine, mirroring the sacramental communion meal that we've just shared within the service. It's important that the communion of our worship not be an empty ritual, but that we live out that sacrament in our relationships with each other as well. In liturgical traditions, every week we get a taste of wine as part of our communion. Communion for us is a sacrament, a sign of God's grace. To echo that sacrament in our commonplace meals reminds us of the sacredness of everyday life. And because it's a little bit special, a little bit rare, meaning you need a lot of resources and a lot of time, many years, to make any bottle of wine. It's not something that you can theoretically easily make yourself, like bread. That rarity wakes us up in that moment to the sacredness of that moment. Giving and receiving hospitality is no longer a matter of life and death, as it was in the first century, but it is certainly life-giving. Like the sacrament of communion, it strengthens us spiritually for the day-to-day aspects of our lives. One form of the invitation to communion, sometimes used in our church, says that the altar table is the place of God's lavish welcome for all. And that's what this miracle of the dozens of gallons of wine represents, a lavish welcome, extravagant, gracious, more than we dare to want or expect. If you believe in an all-powerful, all-loving God, as we do, then in God's eyes, each one of us is a cause for celebration. And that is the hospitality that we are to practice with each other. Because every celebration we have, all the friends that we gather around us, are a symbol of our hope in a future where all will be fed and the wine will never run dry. So the last time that I did an event like this, we had wine tasting in the room. And to research for that, I picked up a lot of bottles from my store. I picked up a bottle from Chile, South Africa, Greece, and Estonia. And it was, you know, a world tour. And those are four places I've never been. I'll be lucky if I get to go to one of them in my lifetime. But for around $20 a bottle, I get to experience this thing that farmers and winemakers have worked for years on, and that it's traveled thousands of miles over the country to get in my hand, so I can say, cool, a wine from Estonia. Never had that before. So I just think that's phenomenal. And even though we live in an age where it's very easy to get imported food and beer and all other kinds of foods, they're not as expressive as wine is of the local region and culture. There's a concept called terroir that you may have heard of in relation to wine. And it's this semi-romantic notion that everything, the actual soil, the actual ground and the history of everything in that place can be expressed in the wine. You can actually taste it. And that may sound ethereal, but the fact remains that no two bottles of wine made from the same region will taste exactly the same. Even sometimes you can have the same wine made from two rows over, and it will taste slightly different, because in some places there's what's called microclimate. So each bottle of wine gives you a chance to commune with that winemaker in that region of the world in that moment in time. And I think that's powerful and kind of mystical. My third point may sound opposite, but it's similar, which is that wine is a way to connect to your own region or locality. I live in Southern California, not very far away from several wine regions. Does anyone here live near a wine region? Perfect. And are you tasting wines there? Because it connects you to a place that people who aren't going to the vineyards can't get. You know, you're driving through the areas, you're standing in their tasting room, which is sometimes just part of the wine cellar, getting to know them. If you join their wine club, you get to know them more. And it gives you an interest in how things like fires and floods and, you know, droughts affect those people. It's a way to have a greater environmental awareness. Because for me, I don't, you know, I will go and I will look at the vineyards. That's interesting to me. But I won't look at tomatoes, for example. It just doesn't interest me. Do you need to go? Okay. Take a card if you didn't.
Yes, please.
I'm still going to try to speed through, and then we'll.
I just got
to
meet my friends. I'm sorry.
No worries. Thanks for coming.
My wife keeps texting me.
Okay, so the fourth point: wine is a universal symbol of hospitality. If you don't know what to bring to someone's house for dinner, bring a bottle of wine. If you don't know what to serve somebody when they visit you, offer wine. Not only is it an enjoyable beverage, also, as I said, every bottle tells a story. And being able to tell a story is also an important part of hospitality. So if you don't happen to know the story about the bottle or the wine that you're serving, say whatever the person at the wine store that sold it to you said. I live near an independent wine store, and everybody there is able to tell some story about pretty much every bottle of wine there. So, I mean, any little fact is part, to me, of the experience of drinking that bottle. Number five, wine is an accessible luxury. For less than $20, you can elevate an average meal into an occasion. Just as a little taste of wine wakes us up a bit in communion to the sacredness of that moment, wine awakens your taste buds for a regular meal and makes you slow down and pay attention. Sipping wine helps you slow down, focus on your food and your friends. And sometimes slowing things down is the greatest luxury that we have these days.
You said earlier that, I thought I heard, that the Episcopal Church also believes that the bread and wine become the body and blood of Christ, which I didn't think that was an Episcopal thing.
I was talking about historically,
okay,
in going back to medieval Christianity.
Okay.
That would be an argument. That's an argument that you can find in really old texts with people like around the time of Aquinas and earlier, that they're trying to figure out how does that happen, because that was the teaching and that was the belief. It's called transubstantiation. And in our, and this actually was incidentally known as the Elizabethan settlement, because in England at her time, Catholics and Protestants were killing each other over what they thought was happening or not happening, because you had very strict Protestants on the continent saying the bread and the wine is not body and blood of Jesus. That's ridiculous. This was also around the beginning of the early beginnings of the Enlightenment, right? So people are starting to reject a lot of this mystical, fantastical stuff. And they're saying, that's not what it is. It's just a memorial. That's like the sort of theological term that they use, is that communion is just a memorial. It's not actually the body and blood. So Elizabeth said, I have no window into men's souls, was her famous quote, meaning, I have no way of seeing what you think is happening when you take the bread and the wine. So if you want to believe it's literally the body and blood, go for it. If you want to believe that it's just something we're doing in remembrance of Jesus, what he did, go for it. And so that is still the teaching in any church in the Anglican Communion.
How about we all just shut up about that?
Exactly, that was kind of her point. Yeah.
Does the Anglican Church embrace as sacred texts the Old Testament and the New Testament?
Yes, and we also, as the Roman Church does, accept the witness of the apocryphal books, aka the Apocrypha. So you might see Bibles that have several texts in the middle there that you will not be familiar with, like Bell the Dragon.
Any more or any less than what the Roman Catholic Church does? It's the same Apocrypha that you're talking about?
It's the same. It is the same. We don't use it very often, but we consider it to be authoritative.